All right, so now we are in what we call our flat space. FLATS is an acronym for final listening and test space. There's three rooms, but we're in one of them at the moment. In this space, three things happen. We do frequency analysis of capsules. We do noise tests of vacuum tubes. But right in front of us right now, we have our technician, Jake, who's going to show us how he is tuning the important FET component that's found both in the TF-17 and the TF-11, as well as our M60. So Jake, tell us what you got going on here.
Sure. So at this station, we are testing the total harmonic distortion of an amplifier to make sure that the FET is operating properly. And there's two stages of doing that. So the first thing we're going to do is tune over here, and we have an acceptable range, as you can see right here, of our total harmonic distortion. So we are going to adjust the pot to get it within that window there. And then the second thing we have to check is the orders of harmonics here. The second harmonic, the red line here, always has to be higher than the third. That prevents the microphone from sounding kind of sterile and weird. And depending on the FET amp we're testing, we will allow that harmonic to go a little higher or lower for a cleaner, more natural sound or a more crunchy, saturated sound.
And what is this screw you're twisting in there to change these things?
So this is a potentiometer in the circuit. It's essentially a variable resistor. So you can adjust that to bias the FET and basically bring up or down the total harmonic distortion in the circuit.
Okay. It kind of seems very similar to the other test processes in that there's a transfer function of some sort, not necessarily checking the frequency response, but I'm looking at the signal flow here. Looks like we're sending out into the microphone, and then the output of the microphone comes back in, and we're probably comparing those signals?
Exactly. It's just sending a pure sine wave out through a generator in that box and just reading what comes back so we can compare the input and the output and see how much distortion the circuit is actually providing to the signal.
So in the case of our circuits, you know, we have the large diaphragm TF-11, which is designed to be as sterile and neutral and clean as possible. But then we would have the TF-17 that has a different adjustment where we're going to raise the second order harmonic a little bit higher from the third to, like you said, to add some saturation. Can you show what that looks like, Jake?
Yeah, absolutely. So this second harmonic here, the red bar, is what is being adjusted when we turn this potentiometer. And as you can see, we can go way up like this. This is going to be more saturated, more crunchy, or you can bring it down closer to the third harmonic, and that's going to be more clean and sterile sounding.
We'll get back to the video in just a moment, but first I want to offer you the free Iconic Mics Guide. It includes the most iconic dynamic mics, condenser mics, and ribbon mics, and what makes them so popular and sought after. You can download that guide for free with the link below or at audiouniversityonline.com/iconicmics. All right, back to the video.
Yeah, and that's something that I've learned after talking to smart people like you guys, is that distortion's not always bad.
No,
it's actually some of it's desirable sometimes.
Definitely.
So when you look at total harmonic distortion, we often think of that as you want it to be as low as possible in every case, but that's not necessarily true, right? Because good and bad distortion plays into total harmonic distortion.
Exactly. And if you take out too much of it, you can kind of remove the character of the sound from it, and it ends up becoming very, very sterile. It doesn't impart any of the characteristics you want from the microphone on it. So
nice.
Yeah.
Is there any rhyme or reason in your experience with Live from the Lab, like when you want that character and when you don't, or is it completely situational?
Oh, great question. You know, it all depends on what you're trying to go for with your final production. You know, if you're looking for something that is audiophile, crystal clear, super natural, super neutral, then you're going to want to go for those sound, those style of mics. You know, for the Telefunken line, our M60 and our TF-11 are going to get you that. But if you're looking for something with more coloration, more tone, more saturation, then you're going to go for maybe the TF-17 or transition to a microphone that has a vacuum tube in it, which will give you even more coloration. And we actually test the vacuum tubes in this same exact space with this same exact equipment. We can show you that process next.
Perfect.
One of the main differences about Telefunken compared to all the other microphone manufacturers in the world is that the majority of the microphones that we make actually use vacuum tubes. So I'm holding a custom jig right here that we use to burn in vacuum tubes, essentially put them under voltage, and we simulate them in use for 24 to 48 hours. And once they've been burned in, we will then start a proprietary testing and listening process, which we do here with the same equipment, the Audio Precision 517. So Jake can show you what's going on here and tell you a little bit more about that. So.
Sure. So over here we have a tube that's been burned in already, and we have it put in a jig, which basically simulates the circuitry of whatever microphone it was going to be in. So we can basically run power through that, and using our Audio Precision equipment, we can get an average reading of what the noise level is for this tube. So put this little hat on. And so this is going to take constant measurements over 10 seconds and average them out, and then tell us what the average noise level of the tube is. And based on our ears and the work we've done over the years, we have limits set up for what is acceptable and not. So this one would fall under the limit of what we're looking for, minus 60.7 dBs in our system. So that would pass, and that'd be okay to put in a microphone.
So vacuum tubes all have a self noise, and depending on the tube and the circuit and how much voltage they're being hit with, that self noise can be different, and it can be same level, but it can be pitched in different ways. So right here we have negative 60, but is that negative 60 or negative 60? You know what I'm saying? So these are strange things that we had to listen to over time to determine, you know, what is the proper resonance and what is the proper gain floor for vacuum tubes. And we want our mics to be quieter than anything else in the industry. So a lot of the tubes that we have in the building are new old stock, which means we have to go through old production tubes, as in they're brand new when we open them up for the first time, but we have to listen to and test them. And honestly, some of the old tubes could have a higher failure rate, where we might only get, you know, 20 or 30% of the batch to work. But vice versa, we also do use newly manufactured tubes from suppliers like New Sensor, Electro Harmonic, JJ, which all have great factories in Eastern Europe. And we put them all through the same exact testing processes, the same burn-in tests. And yeah, they basically, if they're too loud for a microphone and they fail microphone, they can be moved along to something else in the audio industry. For example, like the reverb or the gain stage of a guitar amp that is more forgiving for self noise, certainly in a rock and roll space. So,
yeah, noise is really important when you're making mics, especially because a lot of your mics are used for voice, something right. That's really quiet, requires right. A lot of gain after the fact.
Correct.
And so anytime there's noise and then a gain stage after the word, everything prior to that is going to be brought up.
Correct.
So it's essential, I guess, that's kept to a minimum.
Yep.
And minus 60 dBU,
they're fairly quiet. They range quite a bit. And then we also have a listening setup here too, because sometimes the numbers don't tell the whole story. So it's good to always get a pair of ears on there too. So we'll listen for any kind of inconsistencies or anything as well.
I'll note that we actually have a Pro Tools session that I started like in 2003 or 2004 that's still going to this day that has all the self noise of every microphone that we've ever recorded, plus a bunch of industry standards or competitors, so we can keep them and say, hey, what's a vintage C24 sound like compared to our modern C12, or what is a new Mojave mic sound like against one of our TF47 or Alchemy series mic. So it's fun. We've been listening for a long time, and we have a pretty big database of this stuff. So,
yeah. Speaking of that, it seems that's a recurring theme, that you guys have a lot of experience doing this, and each prior year or decade informs the next,
right?
And how things are done. And,
right. We're building our knowledge. We're saving everything. We have the benefit of being able to digitally recall and go back and look at this stuff. We were able to log all of our sessions in Pro Tools, not to a tape machine, so it's easy to recall the data. So
awesome.
Yeah, man.
In the full video that's on your screen now, we walk through the full process of building a condenser microphone from beginning to end and learn how a condenser mic works in the process. Click the link to watch the full video now, and I'll see you there.